this mandala offering, a particular word, sapu-ge-chuki-charva. So sap is a profound. Ge means expansion or vastness. So profundity and the vastness. And the chu is a dharma, right? Sapu-ge-chuki-charva. So reign of the teaching, which are two aspects, the profundity, profound aspect, and vast aspect, which refers to the two wings of the, you can say, bird. Mind, the empty, you can say, wisdom aspect, the profound aspect. Profound. The profound is a synonym for emptiness. Then the vastness is the vast activities. This is a relative aspect, as vast bodhisattva activity. In this case, it refers to Mahayana teaching. Yeah, so actually we already dive into this core practice. What is core practice? Dharma practice. So that's the kind of today's discussion theme, no? The reason I brought up this topic was that, you know, we all practicing Tantra, most of us, treading the tantric path. And so many different practices now. Yabisqua lineage is relatively simple. Very focused and simple, but you might have come across different kind of practices. This practice, chop practice, idam practice, mahamudra, and what else? So many, and five dakini practices. All these practices. Then, but then, what is it? What's the essence? What's the core of it? You kind of need to go back to the basic, so to speak, again and again. Otherwise, we get really strayed to your practice is a tool, right? Tool to lead us to somewhere, something. Mm. So it's nice to always remind ourselves to come back to the, what's the point of it? What are the basic and the key? As a student, we need to really say, this is it, kind of thing. Of course, there are many ways to talk about it, but I wanted you to be clear about if you are in the Yawispa lineage current river, and then if you are in Dakini's whisper, I kind of like you to know. I'm a follower of His Holiness and also Shantideva and all these great masters before us. And we want to inherit them, those great masters' wisdom. What they are telling us. No, instead of straying too much, going to the our own way, or maybe picking up this practice here, picking here. No, I prefer this idam. I don't prefer this practice, so I don't do nothing like that. So just want to come back to the basics. So the title is The Profound, The Basics, or something like that. Like, yeah, it's a little bit of a paradoxical title, but actually it's true. Basic is very profound. We don't want to ignore that, or want to come back again and again. Okay, preface is too long, so that's enough. And so now, having said that, I want you to ask what you think, what you are paying attention. For example, everyday practice, when you wake up, what's the important things to do? And then throughout the day, we took a refuge, which means Nampa, inner being, which means we are following on this journey. So then what's important? What's paying attention? Or your life is imbued by what? Maybe I should rephrase my question. What's the goal of tantric, or what's tantric enlightenment entails?
I used to have this little quote, supposedly it was the quote of the Dalai Lama's, and it was something like, I wake up every morning with the intention to be of a benefit to all beings. And I treasured that quote, and it was a good reminder. And then this morning I was rereading the Yoga of Arising. This morning what I saw was that we come back again and again, which sounds like something, well, it probably was your commentary. But to this, I will not waste this precious human life this morning, today. I will take the meaning of this life today. And then all the other things that I do, hopefully, are, as you would say, imbued with that that my intention, although sometimes my intention is not that pure, and I'm very aware of it, you know, that I have to always sort of question my intention too. Do I just want to be free from suffering, or do I really want to free other people from suffering?
So then second question, what's that intention leads to? Actualization of that intention leads to, you said free from whatever suffering, of course, yes, but in terms of my second question, what's tantric enlightenment entails? What do we want to reach? What do we want to get? What we want to unveil?
It's the union of, you know, appearances and everything with this view of emptiness.
Okay, appearance of emptiness. It's already empty.
And it is, yes, but I may not be realizing it or living as if it is.
Why? Why you want to unify the both two?
Because that's the way things really are, and I'm living in this delusional life in the meantime and not benefiting anyone or myself.
Yeah, just that when you said about the point of awakening, well, the point of the tantric enlightenment is that would be the awakening of self and others. You know, really getting to that place where creating the causes, conditions, everything for all of that to just unfold what naturally is innately in us, you know, so to hold that and just that tantric, to that union or that weaving of all that we have available to cultivate that, those two cultivations of awakening for self and others.
Yeah. That's what's twofold cultivation, and then purpose of the self and the purpose for the others. All right. So those two have, okay, so that's maybe you can say goal we want to fulfill. Then what's the practice? That's we are focused right today. What kind of practice leads to that? Of course, there are so many practices. What I'm saying is the core of the essence. What do we want to focus on? One word. Hint is Dalai Lama, His Holiness, always. Whatever you attend His Holiness empowerment or teaching, whatever, that's only he teaches. All the idans and all the hands and those things are other things. Those are just kind of parahiro. It's just kind of addition, lip service, you can say.
Bodhicitta, is that the one word that...
Bodhicitta, can you say a little more?
Well, again, there's two kind of the wings or whatever of bodhicitta. And one is the relative bodhicitta, which is sort of the aspiring, engaging. And then the ultimate bodhicitta is the realization of bliss, emptiness, the clear light. I mean, Dharmakaya.
Yeah, sutra teaching they call the emptiness. Yeah, so we are talking about the sapge, you know, profundity and vastness. So practice encompasses of those two things. You know, you can say the method side and the wisdom side. In Tantra, we conjoin both together, especially highest yoga Tantra. Therefore, it becomes a very powerful one practice. And be imbued by those two, then we practice together. It escalates the process of this awakening, tantric awakening we are talking about here. This method side, relative bodhicitta, you know, when we wake up, if we are good practitioner, if we remember, may my life, all my life become a service, welfare of all beings. First of all, maybe, may I not harm anybody? That's the beginning. Just not harming. That's the basis of everything. That's actually a refuge vow, Dharma vow, basis of it. May I not harm anything. If you are able to do that, then may I serve, may I benefit all me. That's the second thought, no? Then third thought could be, may whatever I do, every moment, my activity, benefit, become a cause for long-term purpose of awakening. That's called bodhicitta, complete openness of heart. That's one half of the equation. So important to meditate on emptiness, true nature, to the reality. Because that's the one actually cut through the root of suffering, samsara. Without wisdom, yeah, we can ease the suffering of being. That's a great thing, noble things to do. But as if you are trimming the branches. But only wisdom cannot help. That's wisdom, right? Wisdom, emptiness. So we need to have two wings. That's actually a metaphor, the two wings. Bird cannot fly only one wing. In other words, our practice should be imbued by those two aspects, always maintaining, always thinking about. Even when we do the chow practice is a perfect example, the union of those two practices, union of the cultivation of merit, positive potential, method side, and the cultivation of wisdom. Although we don't cultivate the wisdom, but in other words, more emphasis of realization of wisdom, insight, emptiness. So those two things, always. For example, in the morning you wake up, first wake up with the bodhicitta, right? Because then entire day, whatever you do is imbued by this morning intention. Then in the evening, when you go back to bed, again, review your day, then go to sleep, then in a good term, you're sleeping, then wake up. So like that, repeating. So that's the method side. Then when you wake up, remind yourself, not to remind yourself to become a good boy, good girl, nothing like that. Just as we did in the beginning of this session, see if you can have a felt sense of quivering of your heart. I can't help it. You know, I'm a servant of all being. So that's kind of sense of felt sense, genuine love and compassion, bodhicitta. But if you keep doing that for, you know, many, many years, day by day, then become a part of you. You don't need to force yourself. You don't need to become anybody else. You know what I mean? That's true nature. You know, this bodhicitta, this innate caring is a true nature. That's who you are. And so reminding ourselves like that again and again. Then we sit and maybe meditate. Meditate on emptiness. Little bit of meditation. There are many ways to go about it. Mahamudra Vipassana. So even those people who might not familiar with those, how to meditate on emptiness, but still resting in this interconnectedness, for example, interdependence or dependent origination. So me and other, you can do a little kind of investigation, probing. You know, what's the difference? All dependent on each other. You know, mother, child, they don't exist independently, right? That's a kind of hint, smell of emptiness. Things or person does not exist from its own side as an independent entity. Then started to have a kind of smell of this emptiness, like, not I wouldn't say stink, but the smell of emptiness. Then, but it appear. We use all these metaphors, you know, you learn. Like a person in a dream. When you're dreaming, that the person vividly appears. You know, this morning, I had a dream, you know, my son, he'd already died, but then I was looking for him, like a police officer, I'm asking to look for, you know, those kind of clinging, you know, and as if it appears. But then when I wake up, then I say, oh, that's a dream. That's not truly existing in a person there. So something like that, some kind of realization dawn when you wake up. Then it's applied to everything. Everything is like that. We kind of cling on, we hate, and you know, we objectify, we solidify, all these things. But there's no such a thing to be grasped as an independent external object. You know, something like that appear yet empty. So that illusionary nature, you started to have a sense of it. Every day, you don't need to be on a cushion, but the cushion practice helps as a novice practitioner. But in wherever you are, like a supermarket, you can practice this illusory nature. Actually, quite a good place to practice. You know, people moving here and there. It's like a dream. Did you notice sometimes? Kind of step back as if you are waking up in a dream. You know this one, but it appears. My point is conventional bodhicitta aspect practice as a core, then also wisdom, cultivating, try to get some kind of taste of emptiness, smell of emptiness every day. With those kind of method, help of interconnectedness, interdependence, that's very good way. Interdependence or the dependent arising is called the king of reasoning. King of the reasoning, because it's so accessible to us. It's very easier to understand emptiness from that direction. And also there's other way to go about it. Simply rest in the energy and what's happened. It's like a wisdom unveil. When you have a strong emotion arise, use that strong emotion for your realization of emptiness, empty nature, clear light nature of that, whatever emotional energies. So those two aspects. Then what those two aspects lead to? Of course, self-service or the purpose of the self and the purpose of the others. But in order to serve self, so what do you need to become? That's kind of strange thing to say. But what's the resultant state? I'm talking about if we divide the cause, path, and result. That's usually Buddhist talks about. So we talked about the cause, those two cultivation, right? Cultivation of positive potential, and cultivation of wisdom awareness. Then path is a method. So I talked about method, how to go about it, how to practice bodhicitta, how to practice wisdom. So the path has a lot. There are so many. So that's why we are trying to condense into these two streams. This is the method side. For example, tantric practice, Idam practice is, of course, both are integrated, but more method side. You know, Mahamudra or open awareness practice, for example, or Vipassana practice, those are wisdom side. Then what's the result? Then what are the two resultant state? I want you to be very clear about this. That's what the answer to this question about what tantric enlightenment entails. Because you become like that. So you want to know what you are becoming, no?
Just a Buddha mind. Buddha mind and who and what we truly are. We start living that. We start embodying that and we become that in this world, in this space, we're not separate from that. We've reached our own ultimate refuge, and we express that through this life.
It said the Buddha mind, so that's one half of the equation again. But you said the express, so they're the Buddha bodies, so-called kayas. So there are three ways to classify, like three kaya, four kaya, and so forth, but to condense into the two kayas, you can say, two Buddha's body. But we say the body, kaya is like a dimensions aspect. So first kaya is, you say the Buddha mind, Dharma kaya. Kaya, you can say the body of the truth, that's a literal translation, basically emptiness. Heart. In Tantra, we call the clear light nature of mind, subtlest mind. That one is for the self-service purpose. You attained, you fulfilled your potential in terms of your own potential. Come to this recognition, become or unveil your Buddha nature. So that's the Dharmakaya, that is the formless body, you can say. Then the second half of equation is you have to arise as a body, no? To serve others. Dharmakaya cannot serve others. You fulfilled your own potential. But then now you need to. So in that practice, you always arise. That's the important part, no? You have to arise as a so-called illusionary body or the form body, Nirmanakaya, Trukhu, for example, like His Holiness, Trukhu, Rinpoche, Trukhu, real Trukhu, based on the compassion, they arise. Compassionate expression of emptiness, that illusionary body, or the form body, like Idan body. That's why you guys practicing, no? Idan, for example, Vajrayogini or Tara, whatever you practice Idan. So those two aspects. So in other words, tantric enlightenment entails those two. If I use a technical term, the clear light, innate mind of clear light, that's one aspect. Then the illusionary body, that's the second aspect. The first one, sub-cell, the second part is the self-analysis. So now we draw the line between those two dots, or three dots, you know, cause, path, result. So I want you to be clear about it. So whatever you do, whatever practice you do, you can kind of refer to that. Okay, am I doing this one? You know, is this part of this? If you are practicing Tantra, we combine both together, especially tantric part. Even Sutra, you know, six parameters. The first five is the method part, right? Five parameter method. Then the last one, wisdom section, is the wisdom. But in order to call parameter or far-reaching attitude or perfection, each parameter have to be imbued by wisdom, because this is a bodhisattva path. The first booming of bodhisattva is Arya, we call Arya, is the one who realized the first glimpse into emptiness. So bodhisattva defined by entails realization of emptiness. Of course, emptiness has a different degree, so it's getting defined more and more. That's the first stage. So that's the we are kind of aiming for, so to speak, aspire or inspire for. Otherwise, regardless, no matter how strong we have, I want to help, I want to save all being, you know, but actually cannot actualize that intention. We need to combine both. And also, you know, we discourage. You know, if we have a so strong relative bodhicitta, you know, I want to help. May all my life become a service of all being. But then if we don't have a wisdom aspect, then we kind of discourage, you know, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years practicing, then nothing has changed. Still all beings are suffering. Even I was not able to help one single being from suffering. But if we have a glimpse into emptiness and then develop more understand, deeper understanding, more and more, then that's inspired. Like Shantideva said, what kind of wise person can ever get tired of traveling from the city of joy to city of joy? He said that. That's why Bodhisattva live on again and again, tirelessly. They don't get tired. Because they know that he or she has a glimpse into true reality. His Holiness also, I shared this story. You know, all these refugees came and talks about these torturing or these pains. He was interviewed by the interviewer and said, how can you bear the pain of your children, those refugees? And he said, without the emptiness, I cannot bear. Emptiness and bodhicitta go together, encourage, enhance each other. So then Karmapa's quote again, knowing that all beings do not know this reality, you can say wisdom of emptiness or reality as it is, overwhelming compassion arise on me. So that's a prayer form. May overwhelming compassion arise in me. So that's the Bodhisattva's prayer. More wisdom, more bodhicitta. Don't you think I always say like a parrot? I feel like I'm a parrot, like a bird parrot, repeating myself. You know, more wisdom, more bodhicitta, more compassion, more emptiness, more compassion, more bodhicitta, more bodhicitta, more emptiness. Like a snowball effect. So that's all about the practice. This is that's the one we are treading, this snowballing. We have to use those two wings to enhance or escalate this process. Especially if you enter the Tantra, we have an opportunity. This small window we got. This is the time. At the same time, we don't need to be so, I have to do it. I is too strong. We have to let go I again. Don't get caught by the solidification of the journey or path or this kind of things. Everything is like illusionary. And yet, so knowing that, then embrace all being with compassion and love. So that's the path we are treading.
Yeah.
Of course, everybody is different. Not one way, this way. In fact, everybody is different. And everybody's practice, life circumstances different, everybody's practice different. But what we are doing here is something underneath of that, what's there. Those two things I just wanted to emphasize. As long as they're imbued by the, you know, whatever, even you are doing the physical movement, it could be the expression of emptiness. If your mind is resting, you know, open awareness, and then moving, you know, so that for the sake of all beings, then become a bodhicitta, expression of bodhicitta. And dedication, again, dedicate to bodhicitta. There are many ways to dedicate. One way is to dedicate to bodhicitta, dedicate for the dedicate with a sense of ornament of emptiness, and also dedicate the flourishing of the Dharma. Because without the Dharma, nothing, in a sense that we are not on the path. We met Dharma, so may the Dharma continue to flourish. But in order for Dharma to flourish, we need somebody to friend Dharma. Then we ask for the teacher to live long, and then this current of the river continues. There are many ways to dedicate, but that's a nutshell.